Καταρχήν, καλησπέρα σας. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to this seminar of the Greek Cimac Association, titled "The Gas-to-Stroke Marine Engine Design and Operation." We just do the final arrangements with the seating. We spend a lot of time trying to seat people in the right places, but inevitably there is some mix-up. We have some spare seats in the auditorium, so maybe as we sort of do the changeover before the presentation, after I finish my initial comments, we may stop for a few minutes so that people from outside who can hear me, of course, but they cannot see me, can join in maybe and fill up the remaining two or three or five seats. Anyway, the idea of the seminar was to invite the two major makers of marine dual fuel two-stroke engines to come and give a presentation in parallel, and after the presentation we can have a discussion, a panel discussion, so that the main technical points can come out. And before starting with the presentation themselves, I will give a short, will not take more than 4 minutes, presentation or rather introduction to what is Cimac and what is the Greek Cimac Association. Cimac is more well known than the Greek Cimac Association. Is a worldwide technical association which was founded in Paris in 1951. Brings together engine makers, classification societies, other organizations that deal with diesel and gas engines, piston engines, and a little bit of industrial gas turbines for power generation, for marine propulsion and locomotive propulsion. The objectives of Cimac is to bring together all these players in this rather wide field, and so that they can exchange the experience, and so that the organization can also act as a neutral advisor to international organizations like the IMO. It has a national members association in 26 countries in America, Asia, and Europe. About 350 organizations are, through their national members associations, members of Cimac. I had the honor of being president of Cimac back in the 2001-2004, and the Greek Cimac Association is a national organization in Greece, founded in 1997, to link the marine industry-related companies in Greece, and is affiliated to the international Cimac. Most of our members at the moment are about 30, and we hope that we can increase our membership to 50 in the coming years. Most of our members are shipping companies. Other members are some classification societies in Greece, the local branches, and also some oil companies. One of the present objectives of the Cimac, the local Cimac organization, is to establish a users group, mirroring the existing Central Cimac users group. The working groups of Central Cimac are in a wide variety of subjects. There's a working group in fuels and lubricants. There's a working group on gas engines, the findings of this group are very much related to our today's seminar, and one can look up at the Cimac website and find what are the working groups doing. Anyway, The objective of the local Cimac organization is to establish a user group corresponding with the user group in Central Cimac to provide a forum for dialogue between engine users and engine manufacturers, and we hope to do that in the year which in 2015 that we are running at the moment. And as I said, the objective of the local organization is to increase its membership, because by increasing the membership, the income of the organization will increase. The actual membership fee per year is very modest, I have to say that, is about, is exactly, not about, 300 euro. It's something that you can almost forget, but it's very important to keep it low. 300 euro per company, yes. It's not per person. So we have to increase our membership, and to do so, we are going to have seminars like this one, which are of high level technical content, so as an enticement for new members to come in. So, having said that, I think that we'll go in forward with today's program. If somebody from the anteroom would like to come in at this moment, as they see me, we have about five or six places if somebody wants to join us now. One is here. And the others prefer to be able to do as they please.
They're coming.
Oh, they're coming. We have pushed up the air conditioning a little bit, because with 80 people here, if I do the calculation right, is about 5 kilowatts of heat. So it's 5 kilowatts is not something to right. Anyway, so we have presentations from MAN Diesel and Turbo in Copenhagen, and Niels Kentrup is going to give, I understand, both presentations in one go. Niels Kentrup, Senior Manager, Process Development. Also with us we have Ole Gröne, Senior Vice President, and both of them will be joining in the panel later on with the discussion. So the floor is for Niels Kentrup, and I think that if you press here, automatic.
Yeah. Thank you for the introduction. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Senior Manager, Process Development. Process development is basically everything on a diesel engine that cannot break. That means air, gas, oil, water, whatever. Let's say it's seldom breaking, but it sometimes breaks things. I think I would start a little, even though Pierre Tata started with a little promotion, then I can perhaps also I think, let's say, we have two products on the market, not only the for gaseous fuels and for liquid fuels. We have the MEGI and we have the MELGI engine. Here today I'll concentrate on the DI engine, but if I can get the half hour from Bertel also, I can continue with the LGI also. Then I think this will be okay for me.
Objection,
okay. What we have done, the principle behind the GI engine has basically been, from our point, to make a diesel engine. to continue making what we have been good at for many, many years, make a diesel engine. Even though it's a gas engine operating on gas, we still want to make gas engine, a diesel engine. As you see, let's say we have high pressure gas injection, we are injecting the gas exactly the same way as we are injecting the diesel. We need a little pilot to make the same combustion as we do for the diesel engine. I'll relatively quickly here go to the GI engine performance. I'll concentrate on results obtained on the first commercial engine for the Toyota project, an 8L70 MEC-GI engine. I think what has been important for us when we have made this engine, I will not go into the details of piping and how we have constructed the engine, because this could be a very long story. I'll go to the thermodynamical principle. We have made a diesel engine. We have the same fuel injection rate, the same heat rate going into the engine. We are basing the combustion on air entrainment. Our first expectation, performance, efficiency, emission, NOx, CO, hydrocarbon, are behaving like a liquid diesel engine. Let's say everything we have here we have the heat release pattern, and you can basically not see the difference between the gas engine and the diesel engine. I think we can say that we have confirmed that we still have a diesel engine. All the basic principles are the same, and we can use exactly the same layout of the engine. The same timing, the same compression volume, the same basically everything, turbocharging. We also have, by choosing the diesel principle, exactly the same repeatability as the diesel. We don't have fluctuating maximum pressure. We have stable maximum pressure, even a little more than we have on the diesel engine, but very, very stable operation. And I think this confirms this from our research engine. I think we can confirm that we have the same stability as the diesel engine. Now I'll go to the test result from the 8L70 MEC-GI for Toyota project. This is for a container ship going to operate in United States and the Caribbean, as far as I remember. Isn't that correct, Ole?
Yeah.
Let's say compare gas operation versus diesel operation and what we call specified dual fuel mode, where we have 30-70 and 70-30 ratio in gas and diesel. As you see here, at all load points, this is the heat rate you have when you combust the fuel. You basically have exactly the same heat release rate at all load points. I think here you can actually see that we have a pilot oil injection. This basically disappears when you are at high load because it's so little amount of energy. What you can notice is that we are able to get a little higher heat release and a little quicker heat release, giving you the potential of slightly better fuel consumption of the gas engine. I don't know if you can talk about fuel consumption here, heat rate then at least. When we look on the result, let's say on more global figures, the fuel oil consumption, we have a relative gain basically in the complete engine load range, approximately 5 gram compared to the diesel engine. And we are talking about a completely normal diesel engine reference. There has been done nothing with the layout of the engine to adapt to the gas. We have, due to the nature of methane, slightly lower NOxes. We have eaten most of this gain by having the benefit on the fuel consumption. When we look on other, let's say, emission parameters, hydrocarbon, There's no legislation about the hydrocarbon, but it is an issue with the global warming. We have basically no hydrocarbon. We have no methane slip on the GI engine. It is slightly higher than the gas, but very low still. There is no impact on the CO emission. It is still, let's say, the very good values you see from the diesel engine. It is so low, so I don't think even you could not commit suicide in the chimney of this engine. I think, let's say, when, let's say, you compare, because there was a difference, but when you compare with typical auto engine, you'll see that the methane slip is basically nothing from the GI engine. And again, the CO extremely low. When we want to operate the engine, if you don't have gas enough to operate on full gas load, you could choose to run 70-30, 30-70, and again you see there is basically no impact on how you mix the fuel. You have the same heat release pattern, you have the same performance of the engine if you are running 30 diesel, 70 gas, 70 gas, 30 diesel, whatever you are doing, let's say you will basically have the same performance of the engine, the same good performance of the diesel engine. And this basically go for all engine loads. And the same, let's say, for all the emission parameters, there's no change, the NOx emission, the hydrocarbon emission, the CO emission, and the particulate emission. As long as we are operating on diesel oil, of course this would change if you are operating on heavy fuel oil, but basically when you are operating on clean fuel, you are keeping the emission level like the diesel engine. And again, you will see exactly the same pattern, the gas, the mixed mode, the diesel mode. Let's say it will slowly go up towards the diesel mode, but again with a benefit at all load points, basically. NOx are behaving exactly the same, they are growing slightly toward the diesel. Therefore, let's say the engine can basically be certified in NOx relation as a diesel engine, because this will represent the worst case. We cannot fulfill Tier 3. This is not an option, because it is still a diesel engine. The NOx emission from a diesel engine will be extremely difficult to get below 10 gram per kilowatt an hour or something like that. You could perhaps get it lower, but then it has a terrible fuel consumption. Pilot oil has been a discussion. Here we have the same fuel system as we are using for the diesel combustion, where you can run 110% on diesel. We are able to get it down to approximately 3% full load, a little lower in part load, and of course increasing when you are going down load. We could make this much, much lower if we wanted to do that. This would just require an additional fuel system on the engine. If you wanted to make a dedicated pilot oil system, you could of course do that and then bring the pilot oil amount significantly down. I think the latest GI results confirms that we have a heat rate, an NOx emission, a little better when we are running on gas than when we are running on diesel. We are able to maintain pilot oil consumption of 3%. We are able to run down to 77% load on gas. Of course, it would be nearly 50% gas and 50% diesel. Let's say this would be by nature when you have such a pilot system. We will guarantee that all engines can operate at 10% load on gas. Specified dual fuel mode is available, so you can use the gas you have available. This is up to you how you will mix it. the system will just go where you want it to go. I think you can say that the diesel engine and the gas engine, the GI engine, have the same power density, same combustion control parameter, turbocharger scavenging, exhaust gas temperature. The good part load consumption of the diesel engine, good transient response, robust to fuel quality, you can basically come with whatever you want to come. Perhaps we have to redesign a little on the engine, but I think the first GI test we made actually contained 70% nitrogen, and we were still running. This is not, this is 20 years back. I think Salpatis and me were in charge of that many years ago. simple cycle, cylinder lubrication, we don't, let's say we can use the same still. I'll come back to that a little later. Safety, no risk of misfiring, knocking, no risk of explosion in scavenging air receiver. We have only the gas where the gas should be, where it's combusting. Differences, NOx level is approximately 25% lower. We can utilize these 25% to improve fuel consumption with 1 to 3%. We have basically zero particulate emission, greenhouse gas impact. I think this is general for gas engine, significantly lower because of a very low methane slip. As I mentioned, we will not be able to fulfill IMO Tier 3 by operation on gas. This is by nature not what a diesel engine can do. So we have to combine it with exhaust gas recirculation, with SCR. I'll concentrate on exhaust gas recirculation here. We have no commercial engine, so I cannot show you commercial results in this connection. So this is from our test engine. You will see diesel, GI, compressed natural gas, diesel plus EGR, GI plus EGR. What you see again is the diesel performance, the gas performance, and then you add EGR, and you basically have the same penalty. EGR will give you a penalty. It would be 3-4 grams per kilowatt now, but this will basically be independent of what fuel you are using. If we are looking on the NOx emission, we are starting at a slightly lower level with a gas engine, but fully in compliance with Tier 3, it is actually very easy to fulfill IMO Tier 3 with EGR. EGR can secure Tier 3 NOx levels, also for GI engine. EGR affects GI combustion exactly the same way as diesel combustion. Peak heat release goes down. You increase the late cycle combustion. Increased fuel consumption when adding EGR is exactly the same for GI and for diesel. For GI plus EGR, NOx, CO, filter's Bosch smoke number is very low. I think, let's say, there was a meeting in London in April. It changed a little the scene for what to do about Tier 3 because of the decisions. I think, let's say, what we start a little, let's say, we have the diesel engine, we have the GI engine, we have the LGI engine. Performance, efficiency, emission, turbocharging, timing, basically the same approach for everything. And we continue to have this approach. We offer EGR and SGR for both engine types. Or three engine types, sorry. From 2006 and then until 2014, our focus has mainly been on a fuel flexible solution with both EGR and SCR. Then We have the MEPC meeting in London in April last year. You have to remember to say last year, but we try. All NACAs are also SECAs. No risk of retrofitting for future NACAs. Newest possible NECA I have written 2017. I think I have to update that. It will most possibly be 2020 or something like that, if you look realistic. Ship owners expect SOC compliance by using low sulfur fuels, either normal diesel or desulfured heavy fuel oils. So we have changed our approach a little from this fuel flexible, full fuel flexible approach to a 0.1% sulfur fuel approach. We will continue to have the higher sulfur fuel solution. So of course, if somebody wants to add a scrubber or something else to their ship, we will have and be prepared to offer solutions also for that. I think here is a couple of examples what we can do when we go from the high sulfur, the heavy fuel oil, to the low sulfur. This is the EGR unit on a 60-70 MEC. It could be a GI. I think the low sulfur and the GI would have the same approach. We can make much smaller system. We will have basically the same impact on the engine as a chassis or cooler unit, so shipyards will have no problems in fitting an EGR engine in the engine room because it would not be bigger than a normal engine. Another thing is that when you go from the high sulfur fuel, where you have a lot of particulate, you have a lot of sulfur acid mist, you have a lot of cleaning of the cleaning water, and the water treatment system normally consisting of a collecting tank, a dirty buffer tank, a clean buffer tank, two separators to operate in between the dirty buffer and the clean buffer, and an overboard, let's say, centrifuge to secure that you are fulfilling this. When you go to the low sulfur fuel, you end up in having only a collecting tank and the overboard centrifuge to clean it. Centrifuge, I'm saying, because this is what we are using now. It could be a filter, it could be another system, but let's say a very small system handling both the circulating water and the overboard water. So there will be, when you go from the high sulfur solution to the low sulfur solution, a cost reduction of 30 to 50% when you go for the low sulfur solution. And I think this makes it significantly more attractive. I think you can say that the SCR and the EGR gives you a full fuel flexibility in tier 3 areas. Low sulfur fuel, heavy fuel oil, low sulfur heavy fuel oil is a fully valid option. If you want to use that instead of using normal diesel, this is a fully valid option. The result, no operational limits when charter requires empty LNG tank, when ships are going into dockyard, repair yard, in case of manufacturing of the gas system. Full redundancy in fuel choice is available. Lubrication of the GI engine. I think this is definitely an issue. I think everybody here in the room are aware of, let's say, corrosion, sulfur acid corrosion of cylinder liner, scuffing in the other end. And this has to be addressed when you are operating, partly on heavy fuel oil, partly on gas. So you need a high BN and a low BN source, and you need a mixing unit. And this will be standard for all GI engines. You need to have two systems for lubricating oil. You can always discuss how intelligent this can be made. The simple solution is two tank system, a mixing unit, or a swapping unit. You need to have a storage tank for each object. You have to have a day tank. You have to have a heating device, and you have to, let's say, do something on the engine. We will take care of what is done on the engine. This specified fuel mode will of course also make special requirements to the lubrication of the engine. There's no problem if you're operating like this. Then you can use the low BN oil. If you're operating here, let's say you can do all kind of mixtures. This is what I explained earlier. But this has of course also an impact on the lubrication of the engine. So the strategy will be that you, until a certain sulfur equivalent is operating on low BN oil, let's say increasing the amount of oil, switching to high BN oil, going down to zero, and then increase according to the required ACC factor for the engine. Gas supply system. Here perhaps Mr. Koenig should have been on the stage instead of me, because this is definitely not my specialty. I'm only showing a couple of systems here. You will typically have, if you have LNG tank where you are using the LNG as a supply, you will have to have turbogenic pumps, an evaporator, a gas valve unit, and then supply the engine here. The buck, you will have buck from all tanks. It will build up pressure. It will be difficult to get rid of it. So you need a compressor where you can perhaps use it to combust it in the genset. A typical LNG solution, if you have an LNG tanker, will be that you have to have a high pressure compressor where you have typically five stages. This is an, let's say, complication of the GI engine, no doubt about it. We are working very much to simplify this system. You still need the kerogenic pump, and you have a system capable of handling both the BUD and the liquid natural gas. I think I could show you 20 combinations of this. There will be, let's say, this would depend very much on the requirement for the ship, where you operate, and so on. But I think we are prepared to tailor the system in cooperation with the shipyards. Challenson. I'm sure that the Greek society have heard about problems with gas leakage from the fuel valve when we were testing this first 8L70 MEGI engine. The gas leakage was coming here. You see the gas valve coming into that. We have the ceiling against the gas pressure. You have actually the 300 bar gas pressure here, and we had small leakages coming here on this engine. We had experience from our test engine, from our, let's say, demonstration engines at Hyundai, our demonstration engine at Mitsui, from the test engine at Kawasaki, in total approximately 1,000 hours on gas operation and 2,000 hours on diesel operation, and we have not seen any problems with gas leakage in this area. We had excellent sealing, and this was the reason for continuing that. But when we came to the first commercial order, we saw that we have small cracks, secondary cracks, in the chromium, leading extremely small. We are talking about ppm, but still, let's say, not acceptable leakage for this. And based on about, let's say, we could conclude that this was, that we had to improve the quality of the chromium. I think here you see a number of examples what we have done. We have been in cooperation with Hard Chrome from Switzerland, assisting us in, let's say, making the right quality of chromium. In parallel to that, we have developed an alternative solution where we use a bushing to secure that you, let's say, can manufacture the chromium or the stainless steel hardened. So let's say you get rid of this problem. Both the hard chrome and the bushing solution has confirmed satisfactory operation on the two next engines, the two next commercial engines, the engine for TK Daewoo Shipyard. A little trip down memory lane to finish. Our first jet gas engine was a stationary engine operating at Chiba Shipyard. It was operating from 1994 to 2003. This was actually built with the purpose of taking over the LNG market. This was the main purpose of this power plant. I think we were a little too early there. It is, let's say, it didn't have the impact Mitsui or we expected, but it has, however, been a very good reference for us. Another thing helping us significantly in the construction of the GI engine has been the EU-funded Helios project. EU Transport have, let's say, been very supportive here and supported the development of the GI engine for a three-year period. We had concept confirmation of the GI engine in 2010. We had the demonstration, we had a lot of guests in Copenhagen and a lot of people to press the start button. Ole is not there. We had a demonstration, product demonstration at Hyundai 8S70 MECGI. We had a similar demonstration at Mitsui, a lot of people coming in 2013. And the first orders we got late 2012, the Tode engine, a container ship with gas tanks. The next orders were for LNG carriers for TK shipping. And I think, let's say, this demonstrated we had the engine, it could be sold. We were a little nervous a couple of years. Ole promised not to go on pension before he has sold one, but he has still not left. So I don't think he's doing it that either. But I think what was the result of getting the first orders was actually a catch-up effect. Let's say when you got hold of the cork, let's say the orders, and today we have 140 plus engines on order with GI. The last slide I will show here with information is that the LNG market has been a funny market. Steam turbines dominating the market for years back. Then a period from 2003 to 2009 where a mixture of heavy fuel oil engines and DFDE, four-stroke engine, were the then the DFDE completely took over the market, and now we are just waiting for the GI to take over the LNG market. Clean, safe, and reliable. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Niels, for this presentation and actually keeping the time. Hello.
I exercise.
So we now move on to the two Wärtsilä presentations. I think the first one will be given by Marcel Ott, General Manager of Dual-Fuel Technology. So if we press here, it happens.
Thank you, Mr. Ketatos. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome from my side also here. As mentioned, my name is Marcel Ott. I'm in charge of the technology development for the DF engines in Wärtsilä two-stroke in Winterthur. And I would like to give you an update here on what we consider as being the industry standard when it comes to marine gas engines, which is the low pressure concept. Before we go into the technical part here, I would shortly like to give a bit of a historical wrap up, also some historical background. Gas engines are nothing new, has been in the market for quite some time for different applications, and it actually on our side started already in the 70s with a low pressure, actually two-stroke engine in the 70s, which went into operation, but as was mentioned before, time might have been a little too early for commercial success, and it didn't take off. Also, the high pressure concept on two-stroke has been there in the 80s with the first trials on a test engine, but same there, didn't go into commercial use then really, but then came the four-stroke products here, high pressure concepts, low pressure, and finally then the breakthrough for the marine world here with the four-stroke low pressure DF engines, which you saw before, very much took over the LNG carrier market as you know. Now we're at the footstep here for the next revolution with the low pressure concept on the two-stroke engines, and that's what will go on. A few words on our testing plant here. Some of you might have been at our engine laboratory in Trieste in Italy, where we have a full-scale six-cylinder 50 bore test engine. Has been installed 2011. Firstly, we converted one cylinder to operate on gas to get all the concept trials done. And then in summer 2013, this engine was converted to full-scale gas operation, so to run on gas on all cylinders. And we have used this excellent tool here for mapping or development of the performance control systems, some component reliability tests as far as this can be judged from the testing experience. And we have in the meantime logged more than 1,000 running hours on this engine. So this testing facility will still remain, it's up and running, will also do for the coming year, already quite fully booked, but already now we are at going into a next or a further step here with actually a larger bore test engine, 72 centimeter bore DF test engine, designated test engine, which is now installed at our Japanese licensee Diesel United. We see that there is a strong interest in the Japanese market also for gas-fueled two-stroke engines. And this engine is there, is installed. We have actually started up on diesel only last week, and the commissioning and startup on gas will be done now in the coming weeks. Very good progress there. And of course, we can use this test engine as an additional testing facility, and we can, or I would be happy to present you some actual test results once we have it up and running. The operating principle, you might have seen this before, we have a short animation here. This engine works bit different than a standard diesel engine and what we have seen before. So this is an Otto cycle process when running in gas. You see we have a gas valves here installed on the cylinder liner, injecting gas into the cylinder, and you see the gas being mixed up during the compression stroke with the scavenging air, and then we have a designated ignition system in the cylinder cover igniting the gas air charge at the right timing. So this is a premixed concept here. It's not it's entirely different than a diesel engine, a premixed concept where we mix before we burn. The main benefits of this concept, as we see it here, is clearly the much lower gas pressure than with an alternative concept. So we can guarantee that we stay below 16 bar gas pressure all the time. This allows us to use simple and reliable gas supply system. It allows us to use simple gas sealing. We have seen some slides on the previous presentation, which of course are challenges which we also know from four-stroke engines. But this is a lot more simple here, according to our experience now, with the low gas pressure sealing with standard O-rings and so on. And it also allows, the low gas pressure also allows to have a wide selection of compressors or pumps, which can be piston or also centrifugal types, which of course have a huge effect on cost. Secondly, we have this lean burn autocombustion, which means that we are, when running on gas, we are by default IMO Tier 3 compliant without any additional equipment, so no EGR, no SCR, after treatment technologies, no additional fuel consumption based on that, and no compromise component reliabilities because we have no exhaust gas going through the engine once again. Few words on this lean burn principle as such. What is a lean burn principle? So I said it's an autocycle combustion. We mix the gas and air with or before we ignite it, as you saw before. And this allows us to create a lean mixture, so we have more air than what is actually needed for combustion. And this will result in quite much lower cylinder peak temperatures. You see here a comparison between a diesel and an autocombustion peak temperatures, and consequently in much lower NOx emissions, and as an extra benefit, lower wall heat losses as well. There's no local ridge combustion, which also results in lower particulates as an extra benefit. And another feature here or characteristic of the autocycle combustion, we have the external ignition with a designated system, ignition system, to allow very low pilot fuel quantities of about 1% of the fuel input only. If we have a look at the emission figures, this is a comparison between a diesel engine running on heavy fuel and the low pressure, our low pressure concept on gas. You can see clearly particulates very much reduced, sulfur oxides almost inexistent. This comes simply from the fuel. Then NOx emissions, as said before, Tier 3 compliant, so 85% or more reduction compared to a diesel engine. And when looking at CO2 emissions, or in this case CO2 equivalent, because we already here consider the effect of the methane slip, which comes along with this concept. But then looking at the CO2 equivalent, we see that we are still 15%, so a fair rate here below CO2 equivalent emissions of a diesel engine. So all in all, we can say that the total emission scope or emission picture is a lot improved compared to an engine running according to a diesel concept. And again, that NOx and sulfur limits are already fulfilled when running on gas. Another area of interest is the methane number effect and maximum power output. I have to say, maximum output of an autocycle engine is typically somewhat lower, 10-15% lower than the maximum output of a comparable diesel engine. And it might be connected to methane number, as you see here. This is our power reduction curve, and it shows you that when running methane numbers down to 80, we expect that, or we see that there is no power reduction needed. And if we go below 80 methane number, depending on the rating of the engine, there might be a slight reduction in maximum output. However, from what we know from the four-stroke installations on LNG carriers, for example, we see that the typical methane number range is from 70 to 90. And on top of that, it's also so that two-stroke engines are typically operated up to 85-90% power. And this will result as you can see, in no power limitations of the engine when running on gas, with all the methane number or gas qualities that are to be expected. Knocking is another area which is specific to Otto cycle engines, and here I would like to show you a short comparison here of two combustion cycles. On top here we have a normal combustion, which where we have a normal ignition, we have a normal flame front propagation through the combustion chamber. And on the bottom here, this is showing a knocking combustion cycle. And what is knocking as such? It is something that when this flame front travels through the combustion chamber and the end gas, or the gas which is not yet burnt, becomes overcritical, then it can light off all of a sudden. And this would result in some pressure fluctuations. You can see it here. And this is to be avoided. What we do here is we have a knock detection system based on two things, on cylinder pressure curves, first of all, and on knock detectors, which measure as noise in the structure. And these sensors we have on each cylinder, and they check the combustion for every individual cycle. So the concept is very much the same as an old established four-stroke product. So it's not only about detection, but also about prevention of knock. And here we have again the same control system functionalities, features as on four-stroke engines. Here we have a BMEP, or torque versus air-fuel ratio, chart. And you see there is this knocking area and the misfiring area here at the right end, at the lean end of the mixture. And the control system has to make sure that the engine is operated in this operating window. This is pretty much done by, or mainly done by, adjustment of the air-fuel ratio, and this is something that the control system does automatically. Additionally, we have cylinder balancing to keep all cylinders in the same area, and this will also improve the overall performance of the engine. A few test results here from the test engine in Trieste. Combustion stability is something that is often mentioned. What is combustion stability, or the criteria for it, first of all? It's the variation of IMEP, or torque, from cycle to cycle. And because this is also what the crankshaft will feel and will be represented in the rotational speed. And this is a comparison here of 300 consecutive cycles when running on diesel and on gas, and you can see that the combustion stability is comparable in both modes, so there is nothing to worry about here. As also indicated before, the cylinder pressures, they can vary more, or they do vary more on a gas engine compared to a diesel, but this is just a typical behavior, but is not affecting the combustion or the operational stability. Another test result from the same test engine on load response. This is another area which is often questioned. This is just an example here of a load curve that we have put on the engine with the water brake and the engine speed here, resulting speed. And we see that the control system actually covers with this in both diesel and gas mode. And that we can actually also run the maneuvering speeds, so the regular telegraph speeds, on gas without any issues here. When it comes to fuel requirements, this is actually quite simple. For pilot fuel, the pilot fuel system, there we specify distillate fuels. So for the time being, we have no heavy fuel option, but we specify distillate fuels. But we see that this is very much accepted by the market, because the fuel input is very little, with 1% only. And here we have the same standards as we use for four-stroke DF engines. Same goes for the gas fuel qualities. Same standards again as for the four-stroke established products. And when it comes to heavy fuel oil requirements, there again it's the same as for regular diesel engines. So nothing complicated there. And with that, I would like to come to the conclusion slide. We're very convinced that the low-pressure DF is the technology of choice for the future and is really, in fact, the industry standard based on the running experience, operational experience that we have from more than 1,000 four-stroke DF engines in the field. Based on the incorporated running experience from our two-stroke designs and based on the test results that we have from the test engine, which are very, which will, makes us very confident. Furthermore, the questioned areas that came from the market, the concerns when it comes to methane slip, to power limitations, you see it here, load acceptance, combustion stability and so on. Are very well under control with this engine concept. So with this, I would like to thank you for your attention, and questions can be taken in the discussion. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Kutatas, for giving us the opportunity. Now,
I will try to push that one here.
Yes.
Okay, now we are busy.
My name is Rolf Stiefel. I'm in charge of the sales and marketing within the two-stroke Wärtsilä, and I would like to put a little bit more commercial aspects also into the picture about the low pressure. Yes, the industry standard, this is what we are saying about the low pressure concept created by Wärtsilä over the years. And why are we saying that? It's because, yes, it is well introduced in the market and it has these benefits here. The environmental friendliness is definitely proven compared to a diesel engine. The low NOx particulate emissions are not reachable with a diesel cycle. It's a pretty simple installation if you look at the ship as such. The low pressure concept offers here a minimum of additional auxiliary equipment which is required. It has also rather low operating costs for the operator and owner of the ship, and this is because the overall efficiency of this concept is actually pretty good. We all know that an Otto cycle engine doesn't have the same primary efficiency than a diesel engine. I mean, that's we are not twisting the physical rules which are here. But you have to look at not only the consumption on the engine as such, but you need to look at the whole concept of the ship when you evaluate the efficiency of such a solution. And here we are quite confident that we can come very close to the same results than with the diesel engine. We say that a reliable and safe operation. I mean, more than 1,000 engines are running since many years here on the four-stroke dual fuel. The two-stroke is an addition to it, but the equipment which is tested or which is used in this low-pressure installation is well proven, and it is in operation, and the crews and operators are coping with it very well. And there's always a redundancy. The change to liquid fuel mode is possible at any time. This is an important aspect, and port-to-port operation, last but not least, is possible very well. As Marcel explained, that this engine can actually operate down to idling speed on gas mode. Coming to the commercial side in terms of references, for sure we are a little bit jealous on the achievement of MDT, on the achievement of especially Mr. Gröner in this respect. We have not so many references yet. We have been able to clock about 25 engines now in our order book, variety of different ship types. First of all, some smaller tonnages which are operating mainly or gonna operate mainly in coastal or in Baltic trade or Canadian trade, as you see here, where the SICA, ICA, NICA aspects are playing into the picture, and why the owners are basically selecting this technology. But then also we have been able to get the first references for LNG carriers with the orders in Korea, in Hyundai and in Samsung shipyards for these two projects listed here. The engine power is reduced for the Otto cycle compared to the diesel engine. So the same engine, X62, for instance, shown here, the rating fields, the orange one, is allows a higher power than the rating field, the green line, representing here the dual fuel version of this particular engine. Nevertheless, if you look at where shipyards today are putting the rating points, the selection points in their ship designs, represented here by the dots, we can say that in the most cases we are able to cover these rating points with the same engine type, the same number of cylinder. We are able to have it either on the diesel or have it also on the dual fuel. So there's only very few cases where actually the rating point is outside of the dual fuel version of the similar engine, and this would require an additional cylinder. That's it's one of the disadvantages of the Otto cycle principle, the low pressure gas engine here, that the power density of the engine is limited. Nevertheless, we see that it is not affecting many projects, and we haven't seen a lot of trouble due to this specific topic. Another issue which is quite important is to see also that the consumption pattern, the fuel consumption pattern, is completely different on the Otto process than it is on the diesel process. You can see here the consumption pattern of a typical diesel engine, where you have this kind of low consumption at mid load, whereas on the Otto cycle, typically the consumption is pretty low on the higher load, and then getting higher at the specific consumption is getting higher when you go down below. This will require also different layouts of the ships. So if you go for a dual fuel ship, it is more advisable to use actually higher rated engines in the dual fuel version compared to a diesel engine, because there is no fuel consumption benefit by derating an engine heavily compared to the experience we have on the diesel engine. This needs to be considered designing the ship going forward. Another topic I wanted to briefly touch here is this methane slip. It's a big discussion in the market, and also there's a high level of insecurity. What's going to happen about this methane slip? The methane slip of the Otto cycle is definitely there. We are having a methane slip of roughly 4 grams per kilowatt hour, and the methane as such has also a severe greenhouse gas effect. That's also true. Nevertheless, it has to be considered that methane, if it is emitted into the atmosphere, has a certain time of survival only. It's going to disappear over time. The CO2 is not going to disappear. So in a way, it has a strong effect, but the effect is over time limited. And that's why the gurus in the environmental organizations are typically calculating it and weighting it with a factor which is 25, 28 compared to CO2, and use this figure. So if we do that, and Marcel has shown this figure by adding this small chart bar, the CO2 equivalent is reduced by roughly 15% compared to a diesel engine. And then this insecurity about the regulation on methane, we are pretty much convinced that if ever there would be a regulation for methane, the most logical would be to include it into the same regulation where the CO2, the greenhouse gas emission, is actually included. And that's catched by the EEDI. So basically what we have done here is we are selecting a Panamax bulk carrier, and we are now calculating what would be the EEDI if you would calculate the CO2 equivalent of the methane slip into the picture. And you would see that still, even with this calculation, the EEDI compared to a diesel engine would be much better. agree that for a ship equipped with an MEDI, the EEDI would be even a little bit lower with this kind of calculation going forward. Last but not least, I have brought here two small case studies where we believe it is important to look at, because the benefits of the low pressure system is basically coming from these two factors of having a more simple fuel gas handling system and having a better emission picture going forward. So typically, when you look at an LNG carrier with the low pressure dual fuel engine, we are requiring the same technology than what is used today in the MEDI engine, in the DFBE concept. So you take the boil off gas and you run through boil off gas compressors. These can be turbo compressors. You need a little bit more stages because the power, the pressure is a little bit higher. Also piston compressors can be used. But for sure, from a commercial point of view, the use of turbo compressors is more effective. So you would compress the boil off gas and then bring it directly to the engine at the maximum pressure of 16 bar. The 16 bar is not required at any load. At part load operation, the pressure is much lower, and that's regulated in the gas valve unit. But the maximum pressure required is 16 bar. The same system can also be used for the gensets on board of the ship. They require an even less, lower pressure, and this can be integrated. Last but not least, this is simple and proven technology. It is known in the industry and used everywhere today. Then when you come to the overall consumption, we have done a lot of studies back and forth, and I don't want to say that this is the one and only truth here, but what we typically see and what we have seen from all the yards mainly is that whatever concept you're using for the whole ship, and look at the whole ship, the consumption is pretty similar whether you use the low pressure system or you use the high pressure system. And that's equal for any ship speed. So the consumption of gas and liquid fuel for the whole vessel is pretty similar. The overall efficiency is competitive, even though that the primary efficiency on the low pressure engine is slightly lower than it is on a comparable diesel engine. On top of it comes the benefit of that in gas mode, these engines are already Tier 3 compliant. But then when it comes to the investment cost, I mean, such kind of machinery equipment on board of an LNG carrier is in the magnitude of 30 to 35 million investment. And what we can see is that the high pressure solution requiring these more complex and more expensive compression system is requiring a higher capex than with a low pressure solution. And even though we would calculate in an SCR, we see a dramatic benefit in reducing the capex for this machinery concept using the low pressure solution. And why is it? Because we have more simple compressors. It's only low pressure. It is already tier 3 compliant in gas mode. It doesn't need any EGR additional investment. And it has less power demand also in operation. For a 55,000 deadweight ton tanker, it actually looks pretty similar. I would like to show you a simple concept how to design the fuel gas system. You would have a pressurized Type C tank, and this submerged pump would actually increase the pressure of the LNG to roughly this maximum 16 bar, and from there you go through an evaporator directly in the gas valve unit. So it's straightforward. You have actually all these gas-related equipment integrated into the tank connection space of the vessel. You don't have any extra gas handling equipment on board of your ship. And then in front of the engine, just the gas valve unit to regulate the pressure which is finally needed to operate the vessel. Also here, if we do an OPEX-CAPEX analyze, we come to the conclusion that if you would have vessel operating about 3,500 hours within an ECA zone and roughly 1,500 hours outside of an ECA zone on a yearly basis, the consumable costs are pretty much similar. Here you see if you look very clearly, you see a small benefit here for the high pressure solution because of the efficiency of the diesel engine. Nevertheless, also in such kind of an operation, you would have some savings when it comes to the investment cost, and then also for the operation, because you have less equipment on board. And this is basically, again, coming here from more simple low-pressure gas handling systems, and also that you do not need any additional equipment to comply with the TS3 regulation, because in gas, the low-pressure solution is compliant already. Gas supply is the most simple. Wärtsilä has developed an enclosed gas valve unit. This is a yellow box here. This can be installed in the engine room, and you would have then one double wall pipe which is going to the fuel gas tank, which is on deck most likely. And you have a control panel for that. It's an integrated solution, which is pretty simple and straightforward. The benefits of our concept, we believe, is for sure the issue of the IMO TS3. We do not need any secondary measure with a lean burn auto combustion process in gas mode to reach these IMO TS3 limits. That has a big advantage. And this is then resulting also in lower capex cost, first of all, because no additional equipment is needed. And then the next aspect for the capex is for sure the low-pressure fuel gas handling system, which is only required for the low-pressure dual fuel engine. So overall, it is a proven concept. More than 1,000 engines are operating, and we believe it is the industry standard for engines running on gas, because I mean all the medium-speed engines globally are basically using this technology. Even though that the efficiency of the engine as such is a little, has a weak point compared to the diesel cycle. That's definitely clear. Okay, so I would say this is the final conclusion. I have one last slide. Sorry, I have to bring that one as well, because I would like to announce that at the end, as already announced in summer last year, the two-stroke business of Wärtsilä has been incorporated in a joint venture with the CSSC Corporation, the China State Shipbuilding Corporation. We announced this joint venture already in June or July. June 2014, and on the 19th of January, so on Monday this week, finally all the regulatory approvals and the establishment of the company has happened. Now this new company is actually the old Wärtsilä Switzerland company. It has been renamed as of 19th of January to WinGD, Winter to Gas and Diesel. And this company will continue to develop and to sell and to market the Wärtsilä two-stroke engines worldwide. That was the last slide from my side. Thank you, and now we go to you.
So, first I would like to thank very much the presenters for the presentations. It's always very nice to have such presentations back to back, because one can make up the everybody can make up their minds and draw conclusions. We have obviously two philosophies, two concepts. The one based on the diesel cycle, the other more close to the auto cycle. I was thinking that in Greece we have a lot of political affinity to auto. Our first king was Otto. And before that we had 300 years of Ottoman Empire. So now we will move to the panel discussion, but I think that to change the scene here we need 5 minutes, so why don't we take a 10-minute break so that everybody can have a cigarette or something, or if you don't smoke, whatever. And we come back at sharply half past seven, whilst we arrange here. Thank you very much. So, we move on to the second part of the seminar today, which is the panel discussion. And their presenters, Ms. Kentrup, Ole Gröne, Marcel Ott and Rolf Stiefel, are joined by Manos Gadis, New Buildings Manager at Dynagas, and Vasilis Lambropoulos, Technical Director of Tenamaris. And I hasten to say, both of them former students of our School of Naval Architecture and Marine Engineering, which, despite the overall situation in Greece, still produces people that we are proud of. Well, NTUA on top there is not a company yet. But, as I said, it was nice to hear the presentation back to back, because one can make comparisons and questions can be posed. And I would like to start by the two flanking gentlemen, Vasilis Lambropoulos and Manos Migadis. And I would ask Mr. Lambropoulos, what is his first reaction? What is the first reaction as a technical question to what was discussed?
My first reaction will be that each individual project that you have to apply a technology is different. You have to consider very carefully the operating profile. You have to consider very carefully the operating profile and the specialities of specific application. And at least this is the way we're approaching this in our new buildings. And you will have to go deeply to details and evaluate each individual solution independently until you find a solution which better matches the needs of your vessel. Having said that, we see that the technology is moving very fast, at least the last years. Fuel oil prices have put a lot of pressure, and the market condition has put a lot of pressure to everyone of us to move technologically faster and faster. And with faster moving technology, there are always teething problems when you have a new technology. Now we face with a new challenge. We have the gas engines in two-stroke segment, and we have two new relatively designs. There is a common concern regarding the safety of these two designs, and I think it would be very interesting to hear from both the two makers what are the steps taking in order to ensure the safety of operating in gas, both on the people who are on board and of course the engine itself, to protect it. What are the design steps? What are the how everything, because things can go wrong, and natural gas can find can be found in places that you do not expect it. It can you can have it in the exhaust gas receiver, you can have it in the scavenge space, you can have it in even in areas that you do not normally expect. So you want a design and you want an engine management system that protects the engine and the people on board. So it would be very nice to hear what are the steps, and if the engine management system is that what is protecting the engine, to hear also what happens if the engine management system itself is malfunctioning, or one of more sensors are not reporting the correct values.
Before I give the word, I think that I owe to Ole Gröne to speak first on that, but to give him some time to think, I would like for everybody to consider that situation is the overall global situation is changing rapidly, and we were planning to have this seminar in November, And because of the general strike at the time, we have it today, just before our elections here. But in the meantime, the world situation has changed. This is the price of the fuel. The two dots is the former date of our seminar, and this is today's situation. So just to have it in the back of our minds. And with that, I will go to the areas that were addressed by both makers and give the floor to Ole to give a first reaction to the question of safety and the what is required.
Yeah, let me comment on that, because when we have, of course, been speaking about the high-pressure gas engine for a long time, as Nils showed the engine in Japan ran decades ago, but the question we have got most time has been as to the safety of using a high-pressure system, 300 bar, and for quite a number of years people were scared about it and thought, what about that? But nowadays we don't get questions to that anymore. But we have participated in an awful lot of HACCP and HACCP studies with various classification societies, shipyards, and the customers. And there I think we have mapped every conceivable situation. So therefore we feel quite safe with the engines and also with the systems around it. So this is actually my first comment on that matter.
So practically everything is fine. No comment on that. Okay, good. let's go with the Wärtsilä people, because inherently in the design you have a low pressure injection halfway up the bore. I have the stroke, and maybe you have some. Slippage of gas through the exhaust valve. Is that so? And what are the issues there? Plus the fact that you go through the difficult valley between knocking and misfiring. So your control system has to wind through this situation. So some comments on that.
Yeah, first of all, of course, safety is always the first thing to guarantee, to make sure that the entire system is safe that is installed on board of the ship. And I think there we can again profit a lot from what was done on the four-stroke side. And I can only repeat and say that the concept as we have it on the two-stroke DF engine now is very much a copy of what is installed on the four-stroke engines on a conceptual basis, and the same goes for the basic safety thinking behind. There are a number of differences, as you have pointed out already, related to the gas admission, for example, how to bring the gas into the cylinder, which is a different concept on a two-stroke compared to a four-stroke engine. And there we have also gone through hazard analysis, risk assessments, looking at individual failure cases, what could happen, and eliminating, let's say, the risky situations from that aspect. I have mentioned gas that could slip through the exhaust valve, which is something that is theoretically possible, and there. We see that it is important to have a good adjustment of exhaust valve timings and gas admission timings, since this could also be a source, theoretical source of methane slip. So we see if we have completely wrong timings, we can have gas going directly into the exhaust system, which is something that is of course to be avoided, but this can fairly easily be controlled by having the right parameter tunings there.
My question would be then, are these risk assessments and all the studies available for the end users? Because we understand that you have done this, and you have done this very thoroughly, but it would be much interesting for us to have a good understanding what we have assessed, how you have assessed it, mm-hmm. and what are the conclusions.
What we have available, publicly available, is the engine safety concept. This is a document which we have, which is available to shipyards, to customers overall. The concept or the document describes the basic safety features, operating principles, safety features mm-hmm. behind the concept. What we additionally do, together with classification societies, are FMEAs, for example. And traditionally, the FMEAs have not been opened to, or have been used to discuss with classification societies to get the approvals, mm-hmm. but not been used for public distribution. But the safety concept as we have it today is basically summarizing the outcome of the FMEAs. Mm-hmm. So it's in there, and yeah.
Yes, I have seen the specific document, but as an engineer, I always like to see a little bit more information than a descriptive, let's say, part of how things operate and what to expect.
Does Niels Kemptrup have anything to add on the no problem comment of Ole Gröne?
Perhaps we attach this problem in different ways, but I think, let's say, from a technical point, I think there's two issues which are extremely important with regard to safety, that at least when we are talking about the engine itself. In the DI principle, the gas is combusted the moment it comes into the engine. It disappears, it becomes water and CO2 milliseconds. Milliseconds after it's injected into the engine. I think this is a very safe basic principle for the engine. I think this goes for, I think, both of us, both Vatsal and us, that the moment you detect errors in the system, the fail-safe solution is back to diesel. I think this is perhaps the foundation of the safety concept of basically both the engine, that the fail-safe, if you have failure in detection system, if you have failures in control system, if you have, let's say, any failure, let's say you will be back to a diesel operation which will be regarded as safe. Even there, things can happen, but I also don't think this is a discussion for today.
If I may challenge this last bit a little bit, on the failure of detection. This is based obviously on sensors, and what kind of multiplicity of sensors do you have to make sure that the initial system is giving you the right information?
There will be, let's say, if we are talking about, there will be redundancy sensors many places, but basically not on cylinder pressure, which is one of the surveillance principle. But the moment you detect, let's say, it is a relatively easy and, let's say, repeated function. As soon as you have a failure, you will again, let's say, go back to diesel operation. I think this is the main principle behind it. I think this differs very little if it's an auto process or a diesel process. You have to have the cylinder sensor, and the moment you have anything indicating that you have something wrong here, you stop the injection of gas.
Any comment from the Vatsal or WinGD?
Same principles there, as mentioned. In case of a critical failure in gas mode, the engine can immediately trip to diesel, as we call it, so switch the operating mode to diesel operation within one engine revolution. This is of course one of the principles there, and then it's also clear that critical sensors for not only operation but safety need to be redundant. For example, just to mention one example, pilot fuel pressure. If we are losing pilot fuel pressure, of course we need to react on that. And if it's only a sensor drift, we shouldn't exclude to run on gas, but instead have another sensor to make sure it's well covered.
What about under piston sensors for detecting leakages? Are also redundant per cylinder unit?
These are not redundant, no, but what we see is that we have another redundancy there, not in the sniffer as such, but if we have a leakage that goes into the piston underside, for example, a stuck open gas valve, which we have also tested to see the consequences, then we see that we can immediately detect such a case by cylinder pressures, by knock signals, again within one cycle, and the system will recognize there is something wrong and need to trip the diesel in that case. So it's a secondary measure there, or measure of the consequence, which in a way makes more sense also.
Much faster than the
sniffer. Yes, exactly.
Okay, to change once more, I would like to ask Manos Migadis what is his first, let's say, reaction to what we heard, and what is his, whether he would like to pose a question.
Thank you, Professor Kritados. I think that we face these days a unique situation in propulsion, especially for LNG carriers. Because the TFD propulsion is still quite young, but it is considered old now, because the two-stroke slow-speed diesel came, and of course we appreciate very much the efforts and the technical excellence of both MAN and Wärtsilä, and the competition between these leading companies is of the benefit of the shipping industry. But I still I want to express the like a complaint of shipping companies which they see their investment to be considered old. I'm talking about TFD propulsion. We try to follow up the developments, and we participated in almost all demonstrations in Copenhagen and Trieste, and also in Asia, in Korea and Mitsui, trying to understand and interpret the risks and of this operation. Safety, of course, is the most important, and also reliability. Don't forget that for LNG carriers, all the concepts so far with these engines are with two engines, each coupled to one propeller. That means that in case one engine is out of order, even for a few hours, the vessel will go with one propeller with reduced speed. I want to focus on the NOx emissions, and I would like to ask both MAN and Wärtsilä. First, MAN, I fully respect what you said about commercial things, but we have to know what is the cost of EGR for one standard configuration, because in less than a year from now, the key laying of the vessels, this will be mandatory for ECA zones. This of course explains the several orders made recently to avoid this. And also the penalty, you said, is around 3 to 5 grams. But I would like to express better in terms of load. If this is steady in all the load range. And one question for Wärtsilä. Tier 3 criteria are met in gas mode for XDF engine, but in diesel mode is tier 2. I would like to know if you have any feedback from classification societies, whether the after treatment, the methods will be mandatory, even if the engine is tier 3 compliant. Because in ECA zones, the vessel should definitely have some periods to operate in liquid fuel only. Thank you very much.
Okay, so the question is first to MAN.
Yeah, well, I can give a small comment to the part of the question which I feel is maybe a little bit my side of it, that is to the cost. But frankly speaking, I think this is not the right forum to speak about prices in euro per kilowatt or whatever. So therefore, I would simply just skip that and say that, as Nils said, we are doing a lot of effort to reduce the cost by narrowing the specification to low sulfur applications. Then Nils can comment on the consumption penalties of using ETR.
Penalties, I think actually I had a figure in my presentation indicating the penalties overload from our test engine. Typically the penalty will be 3 to 5 grams, basically a little less in part load than at full load. I think, let's say, 3 grams at 25% load could be a reasonable figure, and 5 grams per kilowatt an hour at full load. Again, let's say, if we are talking about competing technologies here, it is significantly less than the cost for urea, for example, if you want to make NOx reduction by SCR. So this will be an investment, let's say, operation pattern. I think you need to know the complete picture, as was said already from the beginning. You need to analyze the picture also with regard to which emission equipment you need. Do you need it? I think you need it, whatever. But let's say this would be my opinion. Is it SCR? Is it EDR? I think, let's say, only a detailed study of the real case can give you the correct answer.
One small comment on the EGR from my side. If it was only EGR for gas operation, would be any simpler?
It would. It would have a potential simpler solution. Not necessarily simpler. You still need to recirculate the gas. We are doing it on the high pressure side from the turbocharging for many reasons. Basically, because you can make the system small. Basically, because you can integrate it so you don't disturb the shipyards. And let's say also avoiding the critical components of the turbocharging system and the cooling system. That's the reason for choosing the high pressure side. You saw in my presentation that you had 25% lower NOx in a starting point. This simply do that there is a potential to have a smaller system on a gas engine. If that is 25 or 30%, this can, let's say, always be discussed, because if you utilize the full potential, you are throwing away some of the benefit you have in the basic engine. So again, let's say, you can discuss where you have the benefit. I think perhaps we should mention, in combination with the EGR, that the EGR has a significant tier 2 potential. Let's say, we have not been able to investigate this potential to its full extent, but remember, we had tier 1, 17 gram. We had before tier 1, the level of a diesel engine is somewhere today, if we did our utmost, would be around 22, 23 of a two-stroke engine. There would be no penalty in reducing, or nearly no penalty in reducing the NOx from 22 to 14 gram per kilowatt an hour in order to fulfill tier 2 with EGR, with basically no cost in that connection. So let's say there is a future potential in the EGR to make the tier 2 engine better. Let's say it is not, let's say, investigated fully how the potential is. We have seen up to 6 grams per kilowatt an hour potential of reduction of fuel consumption in tier 2 configuration of the EGR. So this has also to be, there is, let's say, a potential in the EGR which is not fully utilized. This will be done in the near future, or as soon as possible. Let's say, just place some orders, then.
Okay, so going back to the original question to Gertzler.
I think it was related to the regulation environment for the T3. As we see it, we are very convinced that with the low pressure dual fuel engine operating on gas, these engines will be fulfilling the T3 requirement. There is no doubt about that. You might still have certain operational questions which typically come up, like what happens when your ships get delivered from the shipyard and you need to go for first loading, and whether you would be allowed then, because you have no gas on board, to actually go through whatever Louisiana through the ECA zone in T2 mode. These kind of exceptional cases, so every 5 years when you come out of the docking, what is then the regulatory requirement? And unfortunately, we cannot reply this fully today, because this is something which is still under process. I mean, this whole regulation and the rules, how they will finally look like, it's not so 100% clear now. And look at the SICA zone. There's it's valid since 1st of January in the Baltic Sea area, and there's a lot of discussion how to measure and how to prove that you are doing this and that and you do the right thing. So for these kind of issues, it always takes some time. But what we have been able to get is the first statements from classification and regulatory body sector. They would fully support that these kind of these one-time exceptional operational pattern would not be against the rule and could be considered as an exception. This will need to be proven going forward. Yeah. And I think the important thing is that there would be more audits and more questions related to that topic, because then it is actually getting some pressure in the regulatory authorities to find solutions to these topics.
Yes. Comment back. Yes.
I would like to add that as per information from IMO, the vessels will be exempted for the maiden voyage to go to load from Noxeca.
But there are cases that might not be only an exception, as you know very well. As you know very well, if we refer to not to LNG carriers, the cargo belongs to the charterer. And there are cases that the charterer does not want to leave you natural gas on board for your ballast leg. So there is a possibility that during the ballast leg, you are forced. You don't have, it's not an exception, you do not have natural gas to burn, and you might enter a neck area.
Yeah.
In this case, you have a visibility what should happen.
Yeah, I mean, in this case, you need to apply some kind of secondary measure. There's no doubt about that. Yeah, that's clear. And then, from our point of view, we would then always, because I guess it will not happen every time, then it makes definitely sense to more cost effective to go with SCR solutions, most likely, which I agree have a most likely higher operational costs, but this is not really relevant if this is not something happening on a regular basis. We are considering, but Marcel can maybe tell about that one. We will introduce the fuel sharing modes in the same way than you have been presenting the fuel sharing. That's also possible actually on a low pressure dual fuel engine in a similar way. Actually, we are doing it every time when you are running the engine on diesel and you are converting it or changing the fuel to gas. You are also running a fuel mix, and that's gonna be introduced as a technology.
Also, the LNG tank. Okay.
What was just mentioned came to my mind. Is an SCR in that case a better solution than having an auxiliary LNG tank somewhere tucked away, just in case?
I think this is then again one of these stories which needs to be studied case by case and project by project. That's another possibility for sure. As I said, you could also, you know, keep your heel out, something still in, as long as possible by running few sharing before or whatever, and still have some gas then when you come to the last 200 nautical miles. But these are things which needs to be studied then in the real cases. And another option is, as you say, to have an auxiliary tank, which has been looked at already for some projects as well.
I see some comment here from the audience.
Just to add on this about the LNG tank, I think would make sense because we have to consider also that the auxiliary engines will have to be TR3 compliant. So SCR will be required on the auxiliary engine. So by having this tank, you can avoid the SCR on the auxiliary engine.
Okay.
We have to consider also that the Type C tank is not exactly very cheap.
No, I fully agree. that's an expensive exercise.
Yes. And additionally, the factor that can play a significant role is the relation between the prices of natural gas and fuel. We have seen that in the past, operators prefer to burn fuel instead of natural gas. And with the cargo belonging to the charterers, and considering the prices, might be also challenging to.
Does anybody from the audience have a question to pose? Yes, Mr. Kupin, please.
Actually, yes. Regarding
pass it on, please.
Kupin from Andrea City. So regarding the technical issue, I believe that will be resolved. We can resolve them. But in order to proceed with, I'm talking about LNG fueled ships, the investment has to be viable, sustainable. And we hear different prices about LNG fueled ships, from 10 million, 15 million, or 20 million more expensive than the conventional. So what is the correct price, if we're, for instance, for a Panamax? And what is the maintenance cost? Because expensive equipment usually has very expensive maintenance. So if we have the whole picture, then we realize in which price difference between LNG and heavy fuel, we can suggest a solution like LNG fuel ships.
Yes. Okay. Well,
should I give a comment on that?
Yeah, I was going.
I don't think there is at this moment a right price, but we have given some quotations for systems and also looked into other people's quotations for systems. But what I can say is that the cheapest part of the difference between a fuel ship and a gas ship, that's actually what relates to the engine, and the most expensive thing, that's the tank. And this, I think, we cannot avoid for quite a while. But it can be done. We are quoting things like that, and other people are that too. So it is done. It exists. We have an order. One of the ships that Nils mentioned, this is actually all the stuff on board is sold by us. So we know what is the relative cost of the tanks and the fuel gas supply system and the engines as a gas engine in that case. So if you have something specific, we can quote.
About maintenance cost?
So far we don't consider any difference on the engine or maintenance cost, because the gas is cleaner than fuel you otherwise would run on, but it's probably expected to be better. We have figures from the makers of the compressors, what they and the high pressure pump, what they expect for maintenance cost. So this can be informed as well.
Okay. Somebody else wants to. Yes, Mr. Salafadis.
We saw the two concepts. We are very pleased because Polymechanos,
Mr.
Kurtatos, he have
on the microphone because they cannot hear you.
We saw the two concepts. This is too much technique.
We are not engineers.
No more. We are very thankful for your presentation. It was really very nice to have the two concepts. I think Polymechanos Cryptatos is the only person who can combine that. In this connection, I have two questions which is common for both of you. The first it is, we have ordered a G type of engine and we have ordered a X type of engine. And for economical reasons, we need to make a retrofit. Is it possible? In the case that is possible, how much expected the relative cost only for the engine, no supply system? The second question, it is lubrication. We saw Mr. Kempro, he threw some lubrication at the colleagues from Videotour. They came also with some comments, but no detailed information. My wish, and I think it is also the other colleagues' wishes here, it is what is the expected wear, what it is expected lubrication amount in relation to a diesel engine. And finally, I have a simple question for my colleagues from Bachelor. I noticed that it was very interesting because your licensees before 2 years ago in Cimac, in Shanghai, they mentioned that it was not possible to detect the ignition. I can see now that you have some possibilities to monitor the ignition. The question is, can you avoid the possibly unexpected ignition, yes or no? Thank you.
So this is three in one, like shampoo, huh?
Unfortunately, I cannot be in contact with the
okay.
Bachelor.
Let's take them one by one. First was the retrofit.
Yes.
Okay, let's take the retrofit first. Yes.
Shall I comment on that? We are in the process for the time being of making a retrofit. We have an order to retrofit two set of 7S70. MEC engine to MEGI, that's in an LNG carrier. And you asked about the cost. But again, this is not the forum for cost talks. But it depends a lot on the size of the engine, what is the retrofit. But so you're talking about a few some percentages. If you take a big engine, I think you sometimes work with big engines, then it could be plus 15% on the engine. For a smaller engine, maybe more. Because some of the equipment is the same per cylinder, other equipment grow with the cylinder size. So it's different. But it's, again, now maybe Nels corrects me, but I always say that it's fairly easy to correct, to convert an MEC to MEGI because power and output and efficiency is the same. So we call it LNG ready as is. We have questions to that sometimes from ship owners. Is it possible to retrofit? And we say yes, and then they ask, of course, next, then what shall we do to make it retrofittable? And we say, do nothing, because it is not such a big job on the engine. Again, as mentioned before, the expensive stuff, that's what brings the gas to the engine and carrying the gas on board. And that, the bigger it is, the more expensive it is.
I think we have a pretty similar comments here when it comes to the retrofit situation. The only difference here again is then for these gas ready that we have to consider due to the little bit more limited rating field that this needs to be considered when you design the ship the first time, or it might have some influence on your maximum speed maybe later on if the ship has not been or the rating point is outside of the rating point for the dual fuel operation. But then for the retrofit, as Ole is saying, I mean, the most comes from the tank and from the especially from the tank and the fuel gas handling system, where actually this stuff is available today because it is used already in many applications. And for sure here we again see that we have this benefit of having the low pressure compared to the diesel high pressure engine. But at the end of the day, a retrofit will never stop because of the conversion of the engine. It will not be effective or efficient because of the other stuff, the tanks especially coming. And here, the operational pattern is number one. We have heard people saying that, yeah, you know, I have an endurance of 15,000 nautical miles, and I want to have the same when retrofitted on LNG. And for sure, this is nobody can pay that. So you need to look much more careful on the size of your tank and where do you want to operate and what will be the required endurance. And by doing that cleverly, then you can reduce the cost quite dramatically by having a smaller tank then.
May I interject here, because we will follow with the lubrication, I won't forget that thing, but with the fuel prices as they are now, do you consider that practically with this current situation, we're talking about LNG tires and gas engines, or is it still with the current fuel prices, the gas engine as a general propulsion unit for ships from the makers first and also from the users as well?
Okay, yeah, yeah. I'll say something. Yeah. I can only say from what I hear from the market, the projects we deal with for the time being, they are all considering gas as fuel on the LNG tankers. And we, as you know, they were built quite a few, I think 46 of them, fuel-burning LNG carriers with two-stroke engines, and they are still fuel-burnings for except one which is now being converted, but there are no new projects at this moment for fuel-burning LNG carriers, not to my knowledge. They are gas-burning.
So, and then when you come to the other merchant ships, I think the drivers are not only the fuel cost. I mean, there is the environmental consideration, which is also important, and you need to put all this in considerations. I mean, we have some projects where the owners have taken this decision now to go for LNG as fuel and to run basically and to operate these ships permanently 100% on gas, because this is what makes sense. I mean, if you do this big investment in all this equipment on board, how can you use it only partly? Then you should use this equipment constantly and burn gas constantly. What they are saying about this situation you showed on the fuel prices, they are saying that the expectations is that, I mean, they are living on the gap between the different fuels, and they expect that the gap between LNG and MGO, for instance, when you come to Sika, is literally staying similar. So that's what they are seeing today. And from that point of view, this is not really hurting their feasibility study too much. But for sure, higher fuel costs are driving owners earlier into this kind of applications than lower fuel costs. I think that's natural.
For the question for using LNG or fuel, at least for the LNG carriers, we have to say the majority have no liquefaction system, so you have to consume the boil off gas. And the question is what you will do above the boil off gas speed. There are cases where the HFO is a better solution in some cases, but this, as Mr. Lavropoulos said, it depends on the agreement with the charterers. For using LNG engines as a fuel in cargo ships, not LNG carriers, we believe that the most important thing is the training of the people, because the industry thinks that this is a simple fuel, but has a lot of risks, and this is where we have to focus, to train the crews and the officers, and all the chain of supplying, the banking, etc. Thank you very much.
I will agree also, and for applying a retrofit or order a new vessel with a conventional vessel, not an LNG carrier, with the capability to burn natural gas, It's a very expensive exercise. Typical quotation figure we have in our mind for an Aframax vessel would be at least $10 million extra to the price of the vessel. So in order to take a decision, you have to factor in the operating profile, how much time you spend in the neck area, what is the price difference between. You have to be willing to take a risk. You have to look in the future for many, many years, even decades, about the fuel relation, the price relation between the fuel and the natural gas. You have to look at the infrastructure in the areas that you are trading. What I can say is that the decision was already very difficult with the high fuel oil prices. Now it's even more difficult.
But nevertheless, it is already a project of retrofit.
Okay, let's take now the second set of questions of Mr. Chalapatis about the Luboy. Actually, I don't remember what the question was.
they know. I think it was mainly related to our part here, as we have not shown anything specifically in the presentations. I think we have seen about a couple of nice slides from Mr. Ken Trump here on that. I would like to reply on it from our side. The approach that we follow here is actually fairly simple, that when running on gas or on MDO, we specify the use of a low sulfur, low BN lube oil, because we have this very little to almost no sulfur in the fuel. So when changing between gas and MDO mode, there is this one BN 15 to 25 typically fuel, which is specified. Lube oil, sorry. When then changing to heavy fuel oil, then of course with higher sulfur contents in the fuel, it would also require higher base number lubricants. And what we can see now so far, and this is partly also from the four-stroke experience, when running on gas, we have a much cleaner combustion. So when it comes to piston running, our expectation there is that that we will have run with the same feed rates that we now use for diesel engines for the time being, until we get some experience. But we expect that we have some potential to reduce feed rates in the future because of a low sulfur content and better piston running behavior overall.
Perhaps the simple answer from our side will be the well-known ACC factor will be valid. This means basically you could go to zero if this, let's say, curve didn't have a minimum. That would let's say we will have to go to minimum lubrication of the engine. It is lubrication, it is not neutralization that
exactly.
is the issue here.
Exactly.
And the third question of Mr. Chalapatis was...
Before going to this to the third question,
all right.
About the lubrication, you said nothing about having in the cylinder gas and the lube oil. Does this affect the lubricity or not? Do you have any effect on that?
The lubricity on the liner wall?
Does it affect the lubricity? Because you have gas now in the cylinder.
Yes. We believe that it rather has a positive effect to have gas in the cylinder, because there is no extra sulfur that comes in, and much less corrosion hazards than when running on heavy fuel. But at least what I'm aware of, there is no interaction when it comes to or in relation to piston running. And then I think was the third question, was it related to self-ignition, if I understood correctly, or ignition of the fuel?
The presentation is so high. Yeah, your licensees, they explained that the ignition was not possible to detect. You have suddenly ignition without possible to indicate everywhere or somewhere. That you mentioned now that you have some monitoring for the possible ignition failure. Mm. Can you avoid such failure, or you have some time delay in the relation to Greece?
Yeah, it's naturally so, or as I briefly explained before, knocking or self-ignition of this premixed gas air mixture is something that, that can happen on an autocycle engine. It's in the nature of the concept. And therefore, the right measures have to be taken there. One important measure is to slightly reduce the power output, because we see that that the tendency for knock or self-ignition, pre-ignition, however you want to call it, is quite much linked linked to the power output. And that is one of the main reasons, or actually the main reason why we have reduced the power output by 10 to 15%, to keep this under control and get some operational margin on that also. And then it's, this is one thing. The second thing is, of course, then in a lot of details that can be optimized, gas admission, gas mixing in the cylinder, for example, is one thing where we, of course, want to have a mixture which is as homogeneous as possible in order to avoid rich clouds with, which would ignite easier. And we have made a lot of optimizations there in the design of the concept to get operational margin to pre-ignition.
Thank you.
Okay. Somebody else wants a question.
Yes, sure. We focused quite a lot on the engines, and it was a very, very nice comparisons. But we didn't touch upon the fuel gas supply systems. Mr. Kemptrup said that there are about a dozen alternatives. There are alternatives in concepts, whether it's compressor, multi-cylinder compressor, high pressure compressors, low pressure, which vary a lot in price, in maintenance, and in complexity, let alone in the overall efficiency of the plant and in the controls. So we would like to hear a little bit more about who is responsible for selecting the supply system. Is it the engine builder? Is it the yard? Some of the yards are building and promoting their own systems. Is it the owner? Because there is a big cost element in it, and cost variant in it. It seems that the MAN turbo solution has more alternatives than the partial solution, being simpler. So a little bit more about the control, the fuel gas system.
For the systems that we have been involved in, and that's not all of them, those for LNG carriers, there we know that various owners have selected various combinations of cryogenic pumps and reciprocating compressors and full or partial reliquefaction. We know the systems which are selected. It is selected by the owners, but we are not allowed to identify what the individual owners have selected, because that's considered a competition parameter. For those projects for container ships, and there I speak primarily of those in the US, there we have been involved and have specified what we want for such a ship, which is just a container ship with one engine and then a gas supply system, and that used the cryogenic system. So this is a very individual what has actually been done. But there are a number of makers, but when you sort of nail them down, there are at this moment not that very many, but now they're discovering there is a market, so probably more will pop up. And this will, of course, have an influence on the pricing.
Yeah, from our side, we can say that the LNG carriers, or in general, we are using the similar equipment what is used also on the medium speed engine. So typically, what is available here is also cryogenic pumps. But with these 16 bars, these are typically submerged pumps integrated into the fuel systems. And then if you go to the LNG carriers where you have the boil-off gas, then the options are also obvious. You have the turbo compressors and you have the piston compressors, where each system has its merits and its disadvantages. So I think the technology is available and is used in the various installations already today. When it comes to operating cost later on,
This is, I think, and complexity, I think this is an issue which needs to be considered. And I agree with Manos here that the crew issue is an important, especially also the bunkering process and making these things right. Maybe one comment on that is that this SICTO has created now this new subgroup called SGMF, which is a non-profit organization to actually promote these LNG as fuel. And their first initiative is actually to look into training requirements and to ensure that the processes for bunkering and operation of LNG on board of the ships is harmonized and optimal.
Thank you.
Okay, well, I think that I'm going to close this session now. We talked about safety, we touched upon reliability, we talked about cost, efficiency, and emissions. More or less, we covered everything. So, first, on behalf of the Greek Cimac Association, I want to thank the presenters that came all the way and gave us their presentations. Also the other two members of the panel for their contribution. And I would like to thank all of you, the audience, for staying for all this time with us. I hope that it was interesting for you. I hope that the non-members of GCA that are in Greece will become members. And the treasurer is here, and he will gladly accept your contributions. And there's also the last part, which is a reception kindly provided by the sponsor of the event, MN and Vertila. So there are food and drinks outside for you to enjoy. Thank you very much, and have a nice evening.